Hello, welcome aboard Historic Ship Nautilus. I'm Commander Brad Boyd, Director of Submarine Force Museum, and Officer in Charge, Historic Ship Nautilus. Today, we continue our video series, Behind the Scenes of Nautilus with the Wardroom. If you're just joining us, we're about two episodes in. You also have an overview and torpedo room episode to watch. And if you have questions about any of this, please let us know. We're doing our best to answer either in the online posts or on the video series the following week. For example, this week, we're starting with a torpedo room question on how we got torpedoes in here in the first place. With that, I hope you enjoy the tour. Here we go. So as I mentioned, last week we failed to cover how the torpedoes got on board Nautilus in the first place. That was done via the weapon shipping hatch. Now I hope you can see the opening here that is about a 45 degree angle. This is the path the torpedo would be loaded via the hatch topside. The torpedo would be hoisted up via a crane off the platform on the pier, and then loaded through this tube, nose down, and then placed onto one of these baskets that you see here. Gently, by the way. The basket would then be moved to wherever it's going to reside in the room, and then they would repeat the process for the next torpedo. It would be the exact same process, only in reverse, to offload any torpedoes that were not actually fired out of the tubes. Today's submarines have a little more room and actually load the torpedo room through a similar hatch, but are able to do it with the weapon completely vertical. A crane outside the ship lowers the weapon through the hatch and attaches it to a hoist that then rotates the weapon down into the torpedo room, where it's moved to its final location and secured. All right, now on with the tour. Now, as we go through this part of the torpedo room, you're gonna see this spot here where berthing kind of opens up. This wasn't fully open here, so this wall, this green wall you see, actually extended out to about this point here, that stanchion, and that was a fully self-contained room. This was opened up so that we could actually have a flow path for museum guests to be able to get through here a little bit easier. So that was actually a fully contained room at one point. Now the scene you see here is of a sailor executing maintenance on a trim and drain valve, which is what the system we use to move water onto or off of the boat for ballast, list, trim, getting water out of the bilges, what have you. And he's got a supervisor, which in this case, you can see the collar device. The anchor means it's at least a chief petty officer, E7 or 7th rank of the Navy, and the star above it actually means it's a senior chief petty officer. So that's the 8th rank in the enlisted Navy. So I'm sure he's enjoying the direct close supervision that he's getting here from his senior chief as he does this maintenance. Now we're going to continue on. We're going to pass a few heads, which the head, by the way, is the Navy term, or it's just a nautical term for a bathroom. So you can see those here. We're going to cover that in a little more detail in a future episode when I don't have glass causing a reflection. And there's going to be a head that I can get to and show you the actual workings of the toilets, the showers, and all of that. So, with that, we're in the wardroom. The wardroom itself is the big open space you see here. Hello, Captain. How's it going? Where the officers would gather, take their meals, watch movies, socialize, conduct training, or operational planning, etc. The staterooms, which is where they slept and their offices were, line the sides of the wardroom, and we'll cover those next week. The food for the wardroom was served out of the pantry. Now, the pantry, as we see in here, was able to cook breakfast on that small little range you see right there. The rest of the food was actually brought up via dumbwaiter, which you see right here. And a dumbwaiter, for those who don't know, is just a system that transports food, linens, utensils, what have you, upward or downward from a space above or below. So in this case, the galley below. It would come up via this dumbwaiter, and you're just seeing the shaft now. We'll see the other end of it when we tour the galley in a few weeks. Come up the dumbwaiter and be served to the wardroom. The other thing in the pantry you may notice is there are cabinets just about everywhere. Cooler cabinets, although in the submarine force we call them pukas, because we stole the Hawaiian word, at least that's the legend is, we stole the Hawaiian word for a small hole. Because of our history in Hawaii, we came up with a couple of words from them as well. Small hole, puka area, but the puka is only as good as the equipment you put into it and how secure it can be held. So some of these pukas are great for linens, doesn't matter if they roll around. Others, if I was to put dishes in an open space and not protect them, they're going to rattle around as the ship rolls on the surface or takes angles beneath the waves and could break. And so you see those little containers, much like you would find at a buffet, for the exact same purpose, to try to prevent or minimize the amount of plates that get broken, which for a submarine is twofold, run out of stuff, and two, you give away your position when loud sounds happen. So there you can see some cups
and storage area, and the sink that dishes would be washed in. With that, we're going to go over to this side real fast, and you see this hole here. It's normally covered by this panel, and then gets taken down so that the wardroom can watch a movie. Now, this is before the days of computers and tablets and cell phones where you could just watch it on your own little device. Before the days of Blu-ray players or DVD players. And before the days of Beta or VHS, if you remember back to that far. The projector would sit on this shelf, go through the opening here, and project onto that screen that you can see that pulls down just in front of the wall. So that's how entertainment would happen in the wardroom back then. With that, we're going to shift over to the wardroom here. So, okay, so we finished the pantry, going on to the wardroom. As I have said, the wardroom was the place that pretty much all social activity for the officers would occur. It was also used by enlisted personnel on occasion. There are only two spaces on board a submarine, pardon me, Captain, that could actually fit people into a kind of a gathering setting. One of them is the wardroom, the other is crew's mess. If you have two training events or religious services, and we'll cover religious services in a little more depth when we go to crew's mess, the wardroom becomes the other place that everybody can meet. So, also you see in the wardroom, so technical manuals are stowed here, storage is kind of used everywhere you can. You have drawers holding multiple pieces of linens, utensils, books, supplies, you name it, something's probably stored in here throughout her time. You also see over here, so that's a speaker, and that's the other speaker, by the way, so older style speakers. But you see communication circuits to be able to talk to various spots on the boat. That is the bearing repeater, so that you can see the scope's bearing and what they the range is as they're determining. And then you have the course, so it's a mirror of what course the ship's headed on, so that the commanding officer, who's sitting right here or in the stateroom, has the ability to see what's going on at all points. You also see audio equipment over there. Some of that was just to play music or play the audio to the video that they were going to watch or the film they're going to watch. And then some of it was so they could process and review the any audio recordings they may have made while on a mission. Now, the wardroom had one other purpose. It served as the ship's hospital. The table is the only place on board where someone can be laid out, and as such, it serves as the ship's operating table. The bench that you see here will actually fold up to be completely horizontal, and you get two beds as a result, and it just kind of hinges right there. And that's so that they can have a recovery spot. Today's submarines go to sea with an independent duty corpsman. This is a Navy corpsman who has successfully completed the combat tour of the Marine Corps, as the Navy provides all medical support for the Marine Corps, and is qualified as an independent duty corpsman. They are not a nurse or a doctor, but have extensive medical training and are certified to perform an appendectomy, emergency appendix removal, if needed. I would not recommend having surgery done on board a submarine. Not because I don't trust our corpsman, but because when I think of a hospital, I don't think of a cafeteria with a makeshift bed that can rock and roll at a moment's notice without any major medical facility to provide support should a complication develop. However, there are times where it would be more dangerous to transfer someone off the ship given weather or the hostile area you find yourself in. The ship's mission may not support leaving the area, or there may not be enough time to get someone to the medical facility. In those cases, it's better to have a fallback option, and this is that option. Now, I mentioned that today's submarines have an independent duty corpsman. Nautilus did too, for most of her career, that is. When she commissioned, however, she had a full medical doctor on board. This is due to the concern the Navy had over the state of the crew's mental health. Not because of the reactor or the first nuclear-powered warship or anything like that, but because she was the first true submarine. Prior to this, a submarine would submerge for a few hours, a day to 2 days at the most. Nautilus was going to go down for 3 weeks. So they had a full medical doctor on board who also doubled as the psychiatrist-psychologist and who do interviews of the crew to determine their mental state and evaluate for future training purposes for the Navy. The crew, being good submariners, did everything they could to convince the doc that they weren't quite right in the head, and at the last second would tell him, "I'm just messing with you, doc." Navy quickly decided that they didn't need a full-on medical doctor, and so they went and changed it to an independent duty corpsman, as they decided that submariners were about as sane as could be expected, given that they did all volunteer to be on submarines. With that, I'm actually going to put this down for a second. We're going to shift over to interview style, kind of, and I will join you in a second to tell you about the first commanding officer, Commander Wilkinson.
All right, so welcome back. We're going to be doing a little bit about Commander Wilkinson, the very first commanding officer of USS Nautilus. So he was actually born in 1918 in Long Beach, California, August 10th to be precise. He went to San Diego State College, where he majored in chemistry. He then went on to teach at San Diego State College for about a year, teaching both math and chemistry. And this is important to remember the math and the heavy science background for him. He then went from there to University of Southern California, where he pursued a doctorate in chemistry. And he had actually completed all the coursework required within about 2 years and was just short of the thesis when World War II broke out. And on December 12th, he joined the Naval Reserve and was assigned to a cruiser and then quickly volunteered for and joined the submarine force was assigned to two different boats that completed war patrols. He did 8 war patrols total, 4 on each. One was the USS Blackfish and the other was on USS Darter. And he was actually on board USS Darter when the Battle of Leyte Gulf started. And he was part of the crew that they sank a heavy cruiser. And then along with USS Dace, they damaged and chased another Japanese cruiser through the Palawan Passage, at which point they actually went aground. It's very navigationally challenging out there. Went aground and got stranded on the rocks, on the reef, and had to be evacuated to the Dace. Now, they tried setting scuttling charges, but that didn't work. They tried blowing the Darter up with torpedoes from Dace, but that didn't work. They just bounced off, or detonated on the rocks. They couldn't get all the way to Darter. So they shelled her from Dace to make sure that the Japanese couldn't actually get anything useful off of them. Now, one interesting story that comes from this period is he was actually the last person on board USS Darter, and that's, he'd already evacuated to Dace, realized that he left the poker book back, and people owed him money. So he swam back to Darter, got on board, got the poker book, and swam back just to make sure that nobody welched on a debt to him. But from there, he went on, became the executive officer of two different boats during the war, the Menhaden and the Raton. But this was not until spring of 1945. At that point, he never actually made another war patrol. World War II ends, and he gets assigned to Oak Ridge National Laboratory. You got to remember his science background. And he's actually working with Rickover, and he's working as part of the team and is credited with actually developing the physics equations that were used to design the prototype for the Nautilus reactor. And so from there, he was selected as the first commanding officer of Nautilus, went through the training pipeline, and then relieved as commanding officer when she was commissioned on September 30th, 1954. Now, it'd be very hard-pressed to say that there was not a famous moment while he was in command. He was in command for 3 years until relieved by Commander Anderson in June of 1957. But the most famous would probably be on January 17th, 1955. At 11 a.m., when Commander Wilkinson transmitted the message, underway on nuclear power. And with that, the nuclear navy is really born. Following command of Nautilus, he went on, even was the first commanding officer of the USS Long Beach, which is a cruiser. And it's the first nuclear cruiser, first nuclear surface ship that the Navy had. So he was the first nuclear CO of two different ships. It just happened to be named after his hometown, Long Beach. After that, he went on, became Deputy Chief of Staff out in Defense Forces for Japan. He was instrumental in the Submarine Safe Program development, and also he went on to become Commander of Submarines Atlantic before his retirement in 1974. And that's Commander Wilkinson. He's probably the most famous CO, along with Commander Anderson, who we'll talk about next week, just a little bit. And after that, it's not that there's unfamous CEOs of Nautilus, but those are the two that have the most stories written about them. Commander Wilkinson for first nuclear-powered vessel, Commander Anderson for taking Nautilus to the North Pole. But we'll talk about Commander Anderson next week and talk about the North Pole trip, actually trips, over some of the rest of this video series. With that, have a good night. Thanks.